Hello, welcome to the Hurricane, Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane, Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I'm Mike Parker, the class instructor. The Hurricane, Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. The time and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoy this lesson, please click the like button and share it with a friend. And if you haven't already subscribed, please do so. That way you'll be notified when new content is posted to this channel. In this lesson, we'll be studying Mosiah chapters 9 through 17. We skipped chapters 7 and 8. We'll return to them in our next lesson. The key individuals in this lesson are Zeniff, the leader of a group of Nephites that left the land of Zarahemla and reestablished themselves in the land of Nephi, Laman II and Laman III, Lamanite kings who ruled in the land where Zeniff's people settled, Noah III, Zeniff's unrighteous son who became king of his people after his father's death, Abinadi, a Nephite prophet who condemned the wickedness of Noah and his people, and Alma the First, a priest of Noah who believed Abinadi's message. The outline of events for this lesson is Zeniff established a Nephite colony in the land of Nephi, King Noah reigned in unrighteousness, the ministry, trial, and execution of Abinadi, prophet of God. Regarding the setting for this lesson, the Book of Omni described a group of righteous Nephites led by Mosiah the First, who left the land of Nephi and resettled in the land of Zarahemla. This lesson is about a group of Nephites who returned to the land of Nephi and reestablished the colony of Lehi Nephi among the Lamanites. Although there are statements in the text that refer to the passage of time, there isn't a starting point that would allow us to identify exactly when these events took place. I've prepared this conjectural timeline. Circa 165 BC, 435 years after Lehi's departure, Mosiah I and his followers arrived in the land of Zarahemla. Circa 160 BC, Lehi plus 442 years. Zeniff led a group of Nephites back to the land of Nephi. This would have been a few years after coming to Zarahemla, when memories of the land of Nephi were still fresh. Circa 138 BC, Lehi plus 465 years. Zeniff's son Noah succeeded him as king of the Nephite colony. Circa 128 BC, Lehi plus 475 years. Abinadi began his ministry to Noah's people. Circa 126 BC, Lehi plus 477 years, Abinadi returned to warn Noah's people. He was tried before Noah and executed. Chapters 9 through 21 of Mosiah are a flashback that recounts the reigns of Zeniff, Noah, and Limhi in the land of Nephi, while Mosiah the First, Benjamin, and Mosiah the Second reigned in Zarahemla. The events in these chapters took place between the end of the Book of Omni and Mosiah chapter 7. The section heading before chapter 9 that begins with "The Record of Zeniff" was translated by Joseph Smith from the Plates of Mormon and is part of the scriptural text of the Book of Mormon. Malachi, the last writer on the small plates of Nephi, finished his record by telling us of a certain number of Nephites who went up into the wilderness to return to the land of Nephi, for they were desirous to possess the land of their inheritance. Their unnamed leader, whom Amalekai described as strong and mighty and stiff-necked, caused some contention among the group, and all but 50 of them were killed. These 50 returned to Zarahemla, gathered a considerable number of additional Nephites, and returned again to the land of Nephi. They were never seen or heard from again. From Mormon's abridgment of the record on the large plates of Nephi, we learn that a Nephite named Zenith was a member of this group. Because he had come from Nephi to Zarahemla with Mosiah's group, he had a knowledge of the land of Nephi, and so he was sent as a spy among the Lamanites in the land of Nephi to determine what weaknesses the Nephite group could exploit when they attacked. But, Zenith wrote, when I saw that which was good among the Lamanites, I was desirous that they should not be destroyed. And so he suggested to the leader of the group that the Nephites sign a treaty with them instead. This leader, whom Zenith described as an austere and a bloodthirsty man, disagreed and ordered that Zenith be taken captive and executed. The band of Nephites fought among themselves, and all but 50 of them were killed. Zenith and the other survivors returned to Zarahemla. Admitting that he was overzealous to inherit the land of our fathers, Zenith collected as many Nephites as were desirous to go up to possess the land, and departed again for the land of Nephi. As the leader of the group of returning Nephites, Zenith approached the Lamanites in peace. The Lamanite king, Laman II, generously agreed to give the Nephite band the cities of Lehi Nephi and Shilom, and he ordered his own people to vacate the land to make room for them. Zenith and his group possessed the two cities, built buildings, repaired the city walls, planted crops, and multiplied and prospered in the land. But Zenith had been deceived. King Laman intended to bring Zenith's people into bondage, that they might glut themselves with the labors of our hands. After 12 years, King Laman began to worry that the Nephites were becoming too strong to be taken as captives. Laman incited his Lamanite armies to attack the Nephites to take their flocks and grain. Zenith armed his people, and they fought in the strength of the Lord, and did cry mightily to the Lord that he would deliver us. The Lord heard and answered their prayers. The Nephites slew 3,043 Lamanites, while losing only 279 of their own men, a casualty ratio of nearly 11-1, and drove the Lamanite attackers out of their land. After this first attack, Zenith armed his people and secured his defenses. The Nephites continued to be productive and prosperous, and they enjoyed another 10 years of peace. King Laman II died, and his son Laman III succeeded him. When Laman III agitated for war against the Nephite colony, Zenith's spies learned of their plans. When the Lamanites attacked again, Zenith evacuated the Nephite women and children to the wilderness. All the Nephite men, young and old, took up arms to defend their people. They depended on the strength of the Lord, while the Lamanites depended on their own strength. Zenith paused his narrative to describe the Lamanites' grievances against the Nephites. This passage explains what the Lamanites believed and why they hated the Nephites so passionately. Mosiah 10, verses 11 to 17, quote, "Now the Lamanites knew nothing concerning the Lord, nor the strength of the Lord. Therefore they depended upon their own strength. Yet they were a strong people as to the strength of men. They were a wild and ferocious and a bloodthirsty people, believing in the tradition of their fathers, which is this, believing that they were driven out of the land of Jerusalem because of the iniquities of their fathers, and that they were wronged in the wilderness by their brethren, and they were also wronged while crossing the sea, and again that they were wronged while in the land of their first inheritance, after they had crossed the sea. And all this because that Nephi was more faithful in keeping the commandments of the Lord. Therefore he was favored of the Lord, for the Lord heard his prayers and answered them, and he took the lead of their journey in the wilderness. And his brethren were wroth with him, because they understood not the dealings of the Lord. They were also wroth with him upon the waters, because they hardened their hearts against the Lord. And again they were wroth with him when they had arrived in the promised land, because they said that he had taken the ruling of the people out of their hands, and they sought to kill him. And again they were wroth with him because he departed into the wilderness as the Lord had commanded him, and took the records which were engraven on the plates of brass, for they said that he robbed them. And thus they have taught their children that they should hate them, and that they should murder them, and that they should rob and plunder them, and do all they could to destroy them. Therefore they have an eternal hatred towards the children of Nephi. Unquote. I'm struck by how, nearly 500 years after Lehi, the animosity and bitterness the Lamanites had for the Nephites was still based upon Laman and Lemuel's hard feelings for their younger brother Nephi. The text repeats that they believed they were wronged three times, and they were wroth with him four times. Do we hold on to bitterness in our lives? Even more troubling, do we pass that bitterness on to our children and their children? Are our children's views of certain individuals or groups colored by what we say and do? Is our anger being passed down through multiple generations? In April 2018 General Conference, Elder Larry J. Echohawk of the 70 told the story of his younger brother Tommy, who was killed by a drunk driver in 1982, and how the forgiveness shown by his parents caused my own heart to soften and opened a pathway to healing. He taught, quote, "The Lord himself declared, Wherefore I say unto you, that ye ought to forgive one another. For he that forgiveth not his brother his trespasses standeth condemned before the Lord, for there remaineth in him the greater sin. I, the Lord, will forgive whom I will forgive, but of you it is required to forgive all men." The teachings of our Savior and Redeemer, Jesus Christ, are clear. The sinner must be willing to forgive others if he or she hopes to obtain forgiveness. Brothers and sisters, are there people in our lives who have hurt us? Do we harbor what seem like fully justified feelings of resentment and anger? Are we letting pride keep us from forgiving and letting go? I invite all of us to forgive completely and let healing occur from within. And even if forgiveness doesn't come today, know that as we desire it and work for it, it will come, just as it eventually did for me after my brother's death. Unquote. The Lord blessed and strengthened Zenith and his forces, and they prevailed against the Lamanites a second time. The small Nephite community continued to enjoy prosperity. Zenith died soon after the battle, and his son, Noah III, succeeded him as king over the Nephites in the land of Lehi-Nephi. Noah did not walk in the ways of his father. He had many wives and concubines, a practice forbidden to the Nephites, and his people did commit whoredoms and all manner of wickedness, and worshipped idols. Noah dismissed the priests that his father had consecrated and installed new priests who supported him. He also instituted a 20% tax on his people to support himself, his wives and concubines, and his priests. Noah built a luxurious palace and many elegant buildings of precious materials and fine workmanship, along with special seating in the temple that his priests could rest their bodies and their arms upon while they should speak lying and vain words to his people. He built towers in the cities of Lehi-Nephi and Shilom, where he could detect the movements of Lamanite forces in the land of Shemlon. Noah placed his heart upon riches and spent his time in riotous living and drunkenness. His priests spent their time with prostitutes. Lamanite raiding parties began killing Nephites in their fields, but Noah failed to post enough guards to deal with them. He eventually sent a large force to drive the Lamanites out of his land. His outnumbered Nephite army was victorious, but they boasted in their own strength. It's at this point in the narrative that we're introduced to the prophet Abinadi. We know very little about Abinadi, other than that he was a man among the people of Noah, and that he spake with power and authority from God. We don't know how or when he was called as a prophet, nor even how old he was. One Latter-day Saint scholar has suggested that he may have been one of the deposed priests who had served under righteous King Zeniff, but he confessed the record is silent on the matter. When Abinadi first preached to the people of Noah, he warned them that the Lord had said to him that he had seen their abominations and their wickedness and their whoredoms, and except they repent, I will visit them in mine anger. I will deliver them into the hands of their enemies through bondage and affliction. They shall be brought into bondage, and none shall deliver them, except it be the Lord, the Almighty God. When they cry unto me, I will be slow to hear their cries, and I will not hear their prayers, neither will I deliver them out of their afflictions. When Abinadi proclaimed, I am the Lord their God, and am a jealous, that is to say zealous, intensely passionate, God, visiting the iniquities of my people, he was alluding to the second of the Ten Commandments, which was the Lord's warning against idol worship. Quote, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of any thing that is in heaven above, or that is in earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation. Unquote. Idolatry was one of the sins committed by Noah and his people. The Ten Commandments would become one of Abinadi's principal arguments when he was brought before Noah. The people of Noah were angry with Abinadi and tried to kill him, but the Lord delivered Abinadi out of their hands. When Noah heard about Abinadi's preaching, he accused Abinadi of causing contention and ordered his officers to arrest and kill him. Neither Noah nor his people repented of their wickedness. 2 years later, Abinadi returned in disguise and preached again to the people of Noah. Four times in Abinadi's previous message, he had warned the people of calamities that would happen except they repent. Now his message from the Lord was, they have repented not of their evil doings. Therefore, I will visit them in my anger. Abinadi made five specific prophecies that would come to pass. First, the people of Noah would be brought into bondage. Second, they would be smitten on the cheek. Third, the life of King Noah shall be valued even as a garment in a hot furnace. Fourth, their afflictions would be so severe that they shall howl all the day long. Fifth, they would have heavy burdens placed upon them. He also left a metaphorical description of their punishments as being like hail, like the hot, dry east wind, and like a plague of locusts. The Lord's final warning to them was, except this people repent, I will utterly destroy them from off the face of the earth. The people of the city hauled Abinadi before King Noah and told the king the terrible things Abinadi had prophesied. They claimed Abinadi pretendeth the Lord hath spoken it, and ingratiated themselves before the king. We are guiltless, and thou, O king, hast not sinned. After spending some time in prison, Abinadi was brought before Noah's priests, who began to question him that they might cross or contradict him. Abinadi's defense began as a dialogue with Noah's priests, and then transitioned into a long monologue that addressed several doctrinal points. The most prominent of these are, he began and ended with instruction on the law of Moses and its relationship to the atonement of Christ. He taught that the God of Israel would himself make atonement to save mankind from sin and from death. He also taught how men and women would qualify to be redeemed by God's atonement and be a part of the first resurrection. One of Noah's priests demanded that Abinadi explain the meaning of Isaiah 52, verses 7 through 10, quoted in Mosiah 12, verses 20 through 24. Quote, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace, that bringeth good tidings of good, that publisheth salvation, that saith unto Zion, Thy God reigneth, thy watchmen shall lift up the voice, with the voice together shall they sing, for they shall see eye to eye when the Lord shall bring again Zion. Break forth into joy, sing together, ye waste places of Jerusalem. For the Lord hath comforted his people, he hath redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord hath made bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God." Unquote. It's unlikely that the priest sincerely wanted to know the correct interpretation of this passage. Rather, he was probably testing Abinadi to see if his interpretation matched the priest's interpretation. If the two didn't align, they could convict Abinadi of blasphemy or another serious crime. Abinadi reproved the priests for their ignorance of the law, their hypocrisy, and for perverting the way of the Lord. Abinadi then questioned the priest about their understanding of the law of Moses. He asked them, "Doth salvation come by the law of Moses?" They replied that it did. He agreed that salvation came from keeping God's commandments and quoted the first two of the Ten Commandments, the foundation of the Lord's covenant with Israel. He then accused them of not living the law of Moses and not teaching it to the people. Essentially, his charge was that they had forsaken God's covenant. Noah ordered that Abinadi be executed for what he had said. Abinadi commanded them not to touch him, for God was protecting him until he finished delivering his message. At that moment, Abinadi was transfigured before Noah and the others in the room. Noah's officers were unable to lay their hands on him. We can compare this to the transfiguration of Moses when he came down from Mount Sinai. Abinadi had the mantle of Moses and spoke to them as if Moses had personally returned to teach them. Abinadi prophesied that after he had finished delivering his message, "What you do with me after this shall be as a type and a shadow of the things which are to come." In other words, what they would do to Abinadi would be done to them. Abinadi next explained the purpose of the law of Moses. He finished reciting the rest of the Ten Commandments. He then accused the priests of not teaching the Ten Commandments, the foundation of God's law and covenant, to the people. He explained the relationship between the law of Moses and the atonement that God himself would make. Mosiah 13, verses 27 to 32, quote, "And now ye have said that salvation cometh by the law of Moses. I say unto you that it is expedient that ye should keep the law of Moses as yet, but I say unto you that the time shall come when it shall no more be expedient to keep the law of Moses. And moreover, I say unto you, that salvation doth not come by the law alone. And were it not for the atonement which God himself shall make for the sins and iniquities of his people, that they must unavoidably perish, notwithstanding the law of Moses. And now I say unto you, that it was expedient that there should be a law given to the children of Israel, yea, even a very strict law, for they were a stiff-necked people, quick to do iniquity, and slow to remember the Lord their God. Therefore, there was a law given them, yea, a law of performances and of ordinances, a law which they were to observe strictly from day to day, to keep them in remembrance of God and their duty towards him. But behold, I say unto you, that all these things were types of things to come. And now, did they understand the law? I say unto you, nay, they did not all understand the law, and this because of the hardness of their hearts, for they understood not that there could not any man be saved, except it were through the redemption of God. Unquote. Noah and his people were like the hard-hearted people of Israel, who did not understand that salvation doth not come by the law alone, and that the performances of the law of Moses were only types, that is to say, symbols, representations, of the things to come in the redemption that would be carried out by God himself. These principles had been taught by their ancestors, Lehi, Nephi, and Jacob, but the priests and people of Noah had either lost them or neglected to teach them. Abinadi quoted a prophecy of Isaiah to teach that God himself would atone for his people's sins. He said that Moses and all the prophets have taught that the Messiah would come and that God himself should redeem his people. God would come down among the children of men and take upon him the form of man and go forth in mighty power upon the face of the earth. In doing so, God would bring to pass the resurrection of the dead, and that he himself should be oppressed and afflicted. As evidence that God should be oppressed and afflicted, Abinadi quoted in its entirety Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah 53 is the fourth and final servant song written by Isaiah about a suffering servant who would atone for his people and be exalted by the Lord. In this song, the servant is despised and rejected by men, but his humiliation wasn't all for nothing, for he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, and with his stripes we are healed. The servant endures all this punishment silently and is buried as a common criminal. Yet he shall see his seed, a subject on which Abinadi will expound, and he shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore God will exalt him. After quoting Isaiah 53, Abinadi explained how the Messiah is God. I've added quotation marks to this passage on the screen to make it more understandable. Mosiah 15, verses 1 through 7, quote, "And now Abinadi said unto them, I would that ye should understand that God himself shall come down among the children of men, and shall redeem his people. And because he dwelleth in flesh, he shall be called the Son of God. And having subjected the flesh to the will of the Father, being the Father and the Father, because he was conceived by the power of God, and the Son, because of the flesh, thus becoming the Father and Son. And they are one God, yea, the very eternal Father of heaven and of earth. And thus the flesh becoming subject to the Spirit, or the Son, to the Father, being one God, suffereth temptation, and yieldeth not to the temptation, but suffereth himself to be mocked, and scourged, and cast out, and disowned by his people. And after all this, after working many mighty miracles among the children of men, he shall be led, yea, even as Isaiah said, as a sheep before the shearer is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Yea, even so he shall be led, crucified, and slain, the flesh becoming subject unto death, the will of the Son being swallowed up in the will of the Father." Unquote. This is one of the most misunderstood passages in the Book of Mormon. Critics of the Book of Mormon have claimed that this passage teaches a form of modalism, an ancient heretical Christian teaching that there is only one God who appears in various modes or forms as he desires. When in heaven, he is the Father. When on the earth, he is the Son. When he enters into the hearts of believers, he is the Spirit. Abinadi did not teach modalism. The true meaning of his teaching becomes clearer when we understand that he was not explaining the nature of the Godhead or the ontological relationship between the Father and the Son. Rather, he was teaching about the divine nature and authority of the Messiah. Abinadi had first restated what he declared before he quoted Isaiah 53, God himself shall come down among the children of men and shall redeem his people. When he said God himself, Abinadi was referring to Jehovah, the God of the Old Testament, who would be born as Jesus Christ. Because Jehovah would be conceived by a mortal woman and dwell on earth as a mortal man, he would be known as the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of God in several ways, but here Abinadi was speaking of one specific way. God would be called the Son of God because he dwelleth in flesh, because he would be a mortal being who would have the capacity to die. Jehovah would also be called the Father because he would be conceived by the power of God and therefore have a divine nature, including the power of immortality, something he could only give up of his own free will. During his earthly life, Jehovah's two natures, flesh and spirit, mortal and immortal, son and father, would be in conflict with one another. But Jehovah would subject the flesh, his physical nature, the son, to the will of the father, his spiritual nature. Therefore, the will of the son will be swallowed up in the will of the father. This dual nature does not mean Jesus Christ would be two gods. Rather, he would be the Father and the Son, and they are one God, yea, the very eternal Father of heaven and of earth. A revelation received by Joseph Smith in 1833 teaches the same doctrine. I've also added quotation marks to this passage on the screen to clarify its meaning. Doctrine and Covenants 93, verses 3 through 4 and 12 through 14. Quote, I am in the Father, and the Father in me, and the Father and I are one. The Father, because he gave me of his fullness, and the Son, because I was in the world and made flesh my tabernacle and dwelt among the sons of men. And I, John, saw that he, Jesus Christ, received not of the fullness of the Father's glory at the first, but received grace for grace. And he received not of the fullness at first, but continued from grace to grace until he received a fullness. And thus he was called the Son of God, because he received not of the fullness at the first. This revelation explains that Jesus is the Father because he was given the fullness of his Father's glory, and he is the Son because he became physical and mortal and lived on the earth. He is also the Son because during his mortal ministry, he did not have his Father's fullness immediately, but received it incrementally, growing grace upon grace, as he was obedient to his Father's commandments in this life. Abinadi further taught that the mortal Messiah will suffer abuse, temptation, and rejection, and he will be killed by being crucified. But through this, God breaketh the bands of death, having gained the victory over death, giving the Son power to make intercession for the children of men. He will therefore be able to extend mercy and compassion to mankind because his suffering satisfied the demands of justice. Only God himself, having the fullness of the Father and the mortal capacity of the Son, can redeem mankind. Abinadi next identified those who are the Messiah's seed, spoken of in Isaiah's prophecy. Mosiah 15, verses 10 through 13, quote, And now I say unto you, who shall declare his generation? Behold, I say unto you, that when his soul has been made an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. And now what say ye? And who shall be his seed? Behold, I say unto you, that whosoever has heard the words of the prophets, yea, all the holy prophets, who have prophesied concerning the coming of the Lord, I say unto you, that all those who have hearkened unto their words, and have believed that the Lord would redeem his people, and have looked forward to that day for a remission of their sins, I say unto you that these are his seed, or they are heirs of the kingdom of God. For these are they whose sins he has borne, these are they for whom he has died, to redeem them from their transgressions. And now, are they not his seed? Yea, and are not the prophets, every one that has opened his mouth to prophesy, that has not fallen into transgression, I mean all the holy prophets ever since the world began, I say unto you that they are his seed. Unquote. Those who have listened to and obeyed the prophets, and who have believed that the Lord would redeem his people, and who have looked forward, or in our case backward, to Christ for a remission of their sins, are his seed, and are the heirs of the kingdom of God. The prophets themselves who preached Christ are also his seed. These prophets, along with Christ himself, are those of whom Isaiah said, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace." Abinadi taught that without Christ's atonement, all mankind must have perished. But his atonement gives him power over the dead and bringeth to pass the resurrection of the dead. Abinadi was not the first prophet in the Book of Mormon to prophesy of the resurrection, but he was the first to use the term the first resurrection, which he did six times in verses 21 to 26. He taught that only certain people have claim on this first resurrection. They are, first, the prophets who testified to the Messiah, second, those who believed the prophets and kept God's commandments, third, those who died in their ignorance, not having salvation declared unto them, fourth, little children who don't yet understand good from evil. At this point, Abinadi got personal in preparation to conclude his defense. Remember, he was addressing the wicked priests of King Noah. Mosiah 15, verses 26 and 27. "But behold, and fear, and tremble before God, for ye ought to tremble, for the Lord redeemeth none such that rebel against him and die in their sins, yea, even all those that have perished in their sins ever since the world began, that have willfully rebelled against God, that have known the commandments of God and would not keep them. These are they that have no part in the first resurrection. Therefore, ought ye not to tremble? For salvation cometh to none such, for the Lord hath redeemed none such. Yea, neither can the Lord redeem such, for he cannot deny himself, for he cannot deny justice when it has its claim." His use of the second person plural pronoun ye at the beginning and end of his chiastic message indicates he was directing his accusation at Noah's priests. He accused them of being in a state of rebellion toward and disobedience to God, which placed them outside the Lord's redemption and the first resurrection. We now come to Abinadi's conclusion to his defense. There shouldn't be a chapter break between Mosiah 15, verse 31, and 16, verse 1. Abinadi's statement is one continuous thought. After declaring that the time shall come that the salvation of the Lord shall be declared to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, Abinadi quoted Isaiah 52, verses 8 through 10, back to the priests. This was the same passage that one of the priests had quoted when they had begun by trying to cross or contradict Abinadi. He now responded with his answer to their challenge. According to Isaiah, "The Lord's watchmen shall lift up their voice, his people shall see eye to eye, and the Lord will make bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations." When that happens, Abinadi said, all shall see the salvation of the Lord, when every nation, kindred, tongue, and people shall see eye to eye, and shall confess before God that his judgments are just. When that time comes, the wicked will howl and weep and wail and gnash their teeth because they would not hearken unto the voice of the Lord, and because they are carnal and devilish, and the devil has power over them. They persisted in their own carnal nature, and went on in the ways of sin and rebellion against God, and the devil hath all power over them. They are enemies to God, and have no part in Christ's redemption. He then repeated that there would have been no redemption, nor resurrection, without Christ's atonement. But there is a resurrection, he affirmed, one for those whose works in mortality were good, the resurrection of endless life and happiness, and one for those whose works were evil, the resurrection of endless damnation. I can imagine Abinadi pointing his finger at Noah's priests when he described those whose works were evil as they who had, quote, gone according to their own carnal wills and desires, having never called upon the Lord while the arms of mercy were extended towards them. For the arms of mercy were extended towards them, and they would not, they being warned of their iniquities, and yet they would not depart from them. And they were commanded to repent, and yet they would not repent. And now, ought ye not to tremble and repent of your sins, and remember that only in and through Christ ye can be saved? Unquote. Abinadi concluded by returning to the law of Moses. If the priests had been teaching it, they would have been teaching that it is a shadow of those things which are to come, for redemption cometh through Christ the Lord, who is the very eternal Father. After having accused Noah's priests of being sinful, rebellious, carnal, and corrupt, Abinadi was condemned to death by King Noah. But one of Noah's priests, a descendant of Nephi named Alma, believed Abinadi's message and pleaded with the king to release him. Noah cast Alma out and ordered his servants to pursue and kill him. Alma hid himself and wrote down Abinadi's words. We'll continue with Alma's story next week. Abinadi was imprisoned for 3 days, after which Noah declared him worthy of death on the spurious charge of blasphemy. Abinadi responded that he had suffered, or allowed, myself that I have fallen into your hands, and that his words and unjust execution shall stand as a testimony against you at the last day. Noah was frightened by this, but his priests encouraged him to carry out the death sentence. Abinadi was executed by being burned alive. His final words were a prophecy that the descendants of the priests who killed him would believe in the salvation of the Lord, but the priests themselves would suffer death by fire and disease, and would be driven, scattered, and hunted. And so Abinadi sealed the truth of his words by his death. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes and this slideshow. Next week, we're going to find out what happened to Alma and the people of Noah. We'll also read about an expedition from Zarahemla to discover what became of Zenith and his people. Remember, the narrative in the Book of Mosiah is not in chronological order. The reading for next week puts the story back into sequence. Mosiah 18 through 21, 7 through 8, and 22 to 25. Read the chapters in that order.